The Chatelaine of Burnt Ridge by Bret Harte. Chapter 1. It had grown dark on Burnt Ridge. Seen from below, the whole serrated crest that had glittered in the sunset as if its interstices were eaten by consuming fires, now, closed up its ranks of blackened shafts and became again harsh and somber chevaux de frise against the sky. A faint glow still lingered over the red valley road, as if it were its own reflection, rather than any light from beyond the darkened ridge. Night was already creeping up out of remote canyons and along the furrowed flanks of the mountain, or settling on the nearer woods with the sound of homecoming and innumerable wings. At a point where the road began to encroach upon the mountainside in its slow winding ascent, the darkness had become so real that a young girl cantering along the rising terrace found difficulty in guiding her horse, with eyes still dazzled by the sunset fires. In spite of her precautions, the animal suddenly shied at some object in the obscured roadway, and nearly unseated her. The accident disclosed not only the fact that she was riding in a man's saddle, but also a foot and ankle that her ordinary walking dress was too short to hide. It was evident that her equestrian exercise was extempore, and that at that hour and on that road she had not expected to meet company. But she was apparently a good horsewoman, for the mischance which might have thrown a less practical or more timid rider seemed of little moment to her. With a strong hand and determined gesture she wheeled her frightened horse back into the track, and rode him directly at the object. But here she herself slightly recoiled, for it was the body of a man lying in the road. As she leaned forward over her horse's shoulder, she could see by the dim light that he was a miner, and that, though motionless, he was breathing stertorously. Drunk, no doubt, an accident of the locality alarming only to her horse. But although she cantered impatiently forward, she had not proceeded 100 yards before she stopped reflectively, and trotted back again. He had not moved. She could now see that his head and shoulders were covered with broken clods of earth and gravel, and smaller fragments lay at his side. A dozen feet above him on the hillside there was a foot trail which ran parallel with the bridle road, and occasionally overhung it. It seemed possible that he might have fallen from the trail and been stunned. Dismounting, she succeeded in dragging him to a safer position by the bank. The act discovered his face, which was young, and unknown to her. Wiping it with the silk handkerchief which was loosely slung around his neck after the fashion of his class, she gave a quick feminine glance around her and then approached her own and rather handsome face near his lips. There was no odor of alcohol in the thick and heavy respiration. Mounting again, she rode forward at an accelerated pace, and in 20 minutes had reached a higher tableland of the mountain, a cleared opening in the forest that showed signs of careful cultivation, and a large, rambling, yet picturesque-looking dwelling, whose unpainted redwood walls were hidden in roses and creepers. Pushing open a swinging gate, she entered the enclosure as a brown-faced man, dressed as a vaquero, came towards her as if to assist her to alight. But she had already leaped to the ground and thrown him the reins. "Miguel," she said, with a mistress quiet authority in her boyish contralto voice, "put Glory in the covered wagon, and drive down the road as far as the valley turning. There's a man lying near the right bank, drunk, or sick, maybe, or perhaps crippled by a fall. Bring him up here, unless somebody has found him already, or you happen to know who he is and where to take him." The vaquero raised his shoulders, half in disappointed expectation of some other command. "And your brother, senora, he has not himself arrived." A light shadow of impatience crossed her face. "No," she said, bluntly. "Come, be quick." She turned towards the house as the man moved away. Already a gaunt-looking old man had appeared in the porch, and was awaiting her with his hand shadowing his angry, suspicious eyes, and his lips moving querulously. "Of course, you've got to stand out there and give orders and tend to your own business afore you think o' speaking to your own flesh and blood," he said aggrievedly. "That's all you care. There was a sick man lying in the road, and I've sent Miguel to look after him," returned the girl, with a certain contemptuous resignation. "Oh, yes," struck in another voice, which seemed to belong to the female of the first speaker's species, and to be its equal in age and temper, and I reckon you saw a jaybird on a tree, or a squirrel on the fence, and either of em was more important to you than your own brother. Steve didn't come by the stage, and didn't send any message, continued the young girl, with the same coldly resigned manner. No one had any news of him, and, as I told you before, I didn't expect any. Why don't you say right out you didn't want any, said the old man, sneeringly. Much you inquired. No, I ordered HEV gone myself, and I would if I was master here, instead of me and your mother bane the dust of the earth beneath your feet. The young girl entered the house, followed by the old man, passing an old woman seated by the window, who seemed to be nursing her resentment and a large Bible which she held clasped against her shawled bosom at the same moment. Going to the wall, she hung up her large hat and slightly shook the red dust from her skirts as she continued her explanation, in the same deep voice, with a certain monotony of logic and possibly of purpose and practice also. You and mother know as well as I do, father, that Stephen is no more to be depended upon than the wind that blows. It's 3 years since he has been promising to come, and even getting money to come, and yet he has never showed his face, though he has been a dozen times within 5 miles of this house. He doesn't come because he doesn't want to come. As to your going over to the stage office, I went there myself at the last moment to save you the mortification of asking questions of strangers that they know have been a dozen times answered already. There was such a ring of absolute truthfulness, albeit worn by repetition, in the young girl's deep honest voice that for one instant her two more emotional relatives quailed before it, but only for a moment. That's right, shrilled the old woman. Go on and abuse your own brother. It's only the fear you have that he'll make his fortune yet and shame you before the father and mother you despise. The young girl remained standing by the window, motionless and apparently passive, as if receiving an accepted and usual punishment. But here the elder woman gave way to sobs and some incoherent snuffling, at which the younger went away. Whether she recognized in her mother's tears the ordinary deliquescence of emotion, or whether, as a woman herself, she knew that this mere feminine conventionality could not possibly be directed at her, and that the actual conflict between them had ceased, she passed slowly onto an inner hall, leaving the male victim, her unfortunate father, to succumb, as he always did sooner or later, to their influence. Crossing the hall, which was decorated with a few elk horns, Indian trophies, and mountain pelts, she entered another room, and closed the door behind her with a gesture of relief. The room, which looked upon a porch, presented a singular combination of masculine business occupations and feminine taste and adornment. A desk covered with papers, a shelf displaying a ledger and account books, another containing works of reference, a table with a vase of flowers and a lady's riding whip upon it, a map of California flanked on either side by an embroidered silken work bag and an oval mirror decked with grasses, a calendar and interest table hanging below two schoolgirl crayons of classic heads with the legend, Josephine Forsyth Fakett, were part of its incongruous accessories. The young girl went to her desk, but presently moved and turned towards the window thoughtfully. The last gleam had died from the steel blue sky, a few lights like star points began to prick out the lower valley. The expression of monotonous restraint and endurance had not yet faded from her face. Yet she had been accustomed to scenes like the one she had just passed though since her girlhood. 5 years ago, Alexander Forsyth, her uncle, had brought her to this spot then a mere log cabin on the hillside as a refuge from the impoverished and shiftless home of his elder brother Thomas and his ill-tempered wife. Here Alexander Forsyth, by reason of his more dominant character and business capacity, had prospered until he became a rich and influential ranch owner. Notwithstanding her father's jealousy of Alexander's fortune, and the open rupture that followed between the brothers, Josephine retained her position in the heart and home of her uncle without espousing the cause of either, and her father was too prudent not to recognize the near and prospective advantages of such a mediator. Accustomed to her parents' extravagant denunciations, and her uncle's more repressed but practical contempt of them, the unfortunate girl early developed a cynical disbelief in the virtues of kinship in the abstract, and a philosophical resignation to its effects upon her personally. Believing that her father and uncle fairly represented the fraternal principle, she was quite prepared for the early defection and distrust of her vagabond and dissipated brother Stephen, and accepted it calmly. True to an odd standard of justice, which she had erected from the crumbling ruins of her own domestic life, she was tolerant of everything but human perfection. This quality, however fatal to her higher growth, had given her a peculiar capacity for business which endeared her to her uncle. Familiar with the strong passions and prejudices of men, she had none of those feminine meannesses, a wholesome distrust of which had kept her uncle a bachelor. It was not strange, therefore, that when he died 2 years ago it was found that he had left her his entire property, real and personal, limited only by a single condition. She was to undertake the vocation of a sole trader, and carry on the business under the name of J. Forsyth. If she married, the estate and property was to be held distinct from her husband's, inalienable under the Married Woman's Property Act, and subject during her life only to her own control and personal responsibilities as a trader. The intense disgust and discomfiture of her parents, who had expected to more actively participate in their brother's fortune, may be imagined. But it was not equal to their fury when Josephine, instead of providing for them a separate maintenance out of her abundance, simply offered to transfer them and her brother to her own house on a domestic but not a business equality. There being no alternative but their former precarious shiftless life in their played-out claim in the valley, they wisely consented, reserving the sacred right of daily protest and objurgation. In the economy of Burnt Ridge Ranch they alone took it upon themselves to represent the shattered domestic altar and its outraged lares and penates. And so conscientiously did they perform their task as even occasionally to impede the business visitor to the ranch, and to cause some of the more practical neighbors seriously to doubt the young girl's commercial wisdom. But she was firm. Whether she thought her parents a necessity of respectable domesticity, or whether she regarded their presence in the light of a penitential atonement for some previous disregard of them, no one knew. Public opinion inclined to the latter. The black line of ridge faded out with her abstraction, and she turned from the window and lit the lamp on her desk. The yellow light illuminated her face and figure. In their womanly graces there was no trace of what some people believed to be a masculine character, except a singularly frank look of critical inquiry and patient attention in her dark eyes. Her long brown hair was somewhat rigidly twisted into a knot on the top of her head, as if more for security than ornament. Brown was also the prevailing tint of her eyebrows, thickly set eyelashes, and eyes, and was even suggested in the slight sallowness of her complexion. But her lips were well cut and fresh colored and her hands and feet small and finely formed. She would have passed for a pretty girl, had she not suggested something more. She sat down, and began to examine a pile of papers before her with that concentration and attention to detail which was characteristic of her eyes, pausing at times with prettily knit brows, and her pen older between her lips, in the semblance of a pout that was pleasant enough to see. Suddenly the rattle of hoofs and wheels struck her with the sense of something forgotten, and she put down her work quickly and stood up listening. The sound of rough voices and her father's querulous accents was broken upon by a cultivated and more familiar utterance, "All right, I'll speak to her at once. Wait there," and the door opened to the well-known physician of Burnt Ridge, Dr. Duchesne. "Look here," he said, with an abruptness that was only saved from being brusque by a softer intonation and a reassuring smile, "I met Miguel helping an accident into your buggy. Your orders, eh?" "Oh, yes," said Josephine, quietly. "A man I saw on the road. Well, it's a bad case, and wants prompt attention. And as your house is the nearest, I came with him here." "Certainly," she said gravely. "Take him to the second room beyond Steve's room, it's ready," she explained to two dusky shadows in the hall behind the doctor. "And look here," said the doctor, partly closing the door behind him and regarding her with critical eyes, "you always said you'd like to see some of my queer cases. Well, this is one, a serious one, too. In fact, it's just touch and go with him. There's a piece of the bone pressing on the brain no bigger than that, but as much as if all Burnt Ridge was atop of him. I'm going to lift it. I want somebody here to stand by, someone who can lend a hand with a sponge, someone who isn't going to faint or scream, or even shake a hair's breadth, The color rose quickly to the girl's cheek, and her eyes kindled. I'll come, she said thoughtfully. Who is he? The doctor stared slightly at the unessential query. Don't know, one of the river miners, I reckon. It's an urgent case. I'll go and get everything ready. You'd better, he added, with an ominous glance at her gray frock, put something over your dress. The suggestion made her grave, but did not alter her color. A moment later she entered the room. It was the one that had always been set apart for her brother, the very bed on which the unconscious man lay had been arranged that morning with her own hands. Something of this passed through her mind as she saw that the doctor had wheeled it beneath the strong light in the center of the room, stripped its outer coverings with professional thoughtfulness, and rearranged the mattresses. But it did not seem like the same room. There was a pungent odor in the air from some freshly opened file, an almost feminine neatness and luxury in an open Morocco case like a jewel box on the table, shining with spotless steel. At the head of the bed, one of her own servants, the powerful mill foreman, was assisting with the mingled curiosity and blasé experience of one accustomed to smashed and lacerated digits. At first she did not look at the central unconscious figure on the bed, whose suffering seemed to her to have been vicariously transferred to the concerned, eager, and drawn faces that looked down upon its immunity. Then she femininely recoiled before the bared white neck and shoulders displayed above the quilt, until, forcing herself to look upon the face half concealed by bandages and the head from which the dark tangles of hair had been ruthlessly sheared, she began to share the doctor's unconcern in his personality. What mattered who or what he was? It was a case. The operation began. With the same earnest intelligence that she had previously shown, she quickly and noiselessly obeyed the doctor's whispered orders, and even half anticipated them. She was conscious of a singular curiosity that, far from being mean or ignoble, seemed to lift her not only above the ordinary weaknesses of her own sex, but made her superior to the men around her. Almost before she knew it, the operation was over, and she regarded with equal curiosity the ostentatious solicitude with which the doctor seemed to be wiping his fateful instrument that bore an odd resemblance to a silver-handled center bit. The stertorous breathing below the bandages had given way to a fainter but more natural respiration. There was a moment of suspense. The doctor's hand left the pulse and lifted the closed eyelid of the sufferer. A slight movement passed over the figure. The sluggish face had cleared. Life seemed to struggle back into it before even the dull eyes participated in the glow. Dr. Duchesne, with a sudden gesture, waved aside his companions, but not before Josephine had bent her head eagerly forward. He is coming too, she said. At the sound of that deep clear voice, the first to break the hush of the room, the dull eyes leaped up, and the head turned in its direction. The lips moved and uttered a single rapid sentence. The girl recoiled. You're all right now, said the doctor, cheerfully, intent only upon the form before him. The lips moved again, but this time feebly and vacantly, the eyes were staring vaguely around. What's matter? What's all about? Said the man, thickly. You've had a fall. Think a moment. Where do you live? Again the lips moved, but this time only to emit a confused, incoherent murmur. Dr. Duchesne looked grave, but recovered himself quickly. That will do. Leave him alone now, he said brusquely to the others. But Josephine lingered. He spoke well enough just now, she said eagerly. Did you hear what he said? Not exactly, said the doctor, abstractedly, gazing at the man. He said, you'll have to kill me first, said Josephine, slowly. Humph, said the doctor, passing his hand backwards and forwards before the man's eyes to note any change in the staring pupils. Yes, continued Josephine, gravely. I suppose, she added, cautiously, he was thinking of the operation of what you had just done to him. What I had done to him. Oh, yes. Chapter 2. Before noon the next day it was known throughout Burnt Ridge Valley that Dr. Duchesne had performed a difficult operation upon an unknown man, who had been picked up unconscious from a fall, and carried to Burnt Ridge Ranch. But although the unfortunate man's life was saved by the operation, he had only momentarily recovered consciousness, relapsing into a semi-idiotic state, which effectively stopped the discovery of any clue to his friends or his identity. As it was evidently an accident, which, in that rude community and even in some more civilized ones, conveyed a vague impression of some contributory incapacity on the part of the victim, or some providential interference of a retributive character, Burnt Ridge gave itself little trouble about it. It is unnecessary to say that Mr. and Mrs. Forsyth gave themselves and Josephine much more. They had a theory and a grievance. Satisfied from the first that the alleged victim was a drunken tramp, who submitted to have a whole board in his head in order to foist himself upon the ranch, they were loud in their protests, even hinting at a conspiracy between Josephine and the stranger to supplant her brother in the property, as he had already in the spare bedroom. "Didn't all that year happen the very night she pretended to go for Stephen, eh?" said Mrs. Forsyth. "Tell me that. And didn't she have it all arranged with the buggy to bring him here, as that sneaking doctor let out, eh? Looks mighty curious, don't it?" she muttered darkly to the old man. But although that gentleman, even from his own selfish view, would scarcely have submitted to a surgical operation and later idiocy as the price of ensuring comfortable dependency, he had no doubt others were base enough to do it, and lent a willing ear to his wife's suspicions. Josephine's personal knowledge of the stranger went little further. Dr. Duchesne had confessed to her his professional disappointment at the incomplete results of the operation. He had saved the man's life, but as yet not his reason. There was still hope, however, for the diagnosis revealed nothing that might prejudice a favorable progress. It was a most interesting case. He would watch it carefully, and as soon as the patient could be removed would take him to the county hospital, where, under his own eyes, the poor fellow would have the benefit of the latest science and the highest specialists. Physically, he was doing remarkably well, indeed, he must have been a fine young chap, free from blood taint or vicious complication, whose flesh had healed like an infant's. It should be recorded that it was at this juncture that Mrs. Forsyth first learnt that a silver plate let into the artful stranger's skull was an adjunct of the healing process. Convinced that this infamous extravagance was part and parcel of the conspiracy, and was only the beginning of other assimilations of the Forsyth's metallic substance, that the plate was probably polished and burnished with a fulsome inscription to the doctor's skill, and would pass into the possession and adornment of a perfect stranger, her rage knew no bounds. He or his friends ought to be made to pay for it or work it out. In vain it was declared that a few dollars were all that was found in the man's pocket, and that no memoranda gave any indication of his name, friends, or history beyond the suggestion that he came from a distance. This was clearly a part of the conspiracy. Even Josephine's practical good sense was obliged to take note of this singular absence of all record regarding him, and the apparent obliteration of everything that might be responsible for his ultimate fate. Homeless, friendless, helpless, and even nameless, the unfortunate man of 25 was thus left to the tender mercies of the mistress of Burnt Ridge Ranch, as if he had been a newborn foundling laid at her door. But this mere claim of weakness was not all, it was supplemented by a singular personal appeal to Josephine's nature. From the time that he turned his head towards her voice on that fateful night, his eyes had always followed her around the room with a wondering, yearning, canine half-intelligence. Without being able to convince herself that he understood her better than his regular attendant furnished by the doctor, she could not fail to see that he obeyed her implicitly, and that whenever any difficulty arose between him and his nurse she was always appealed to. Her pride in this proof of her practical sovereignty was flattered, and when Dr. Duchesne finally admitted that although the patient was now physically able to be removed to the hospital, yet he would lose in the change that very strong factor which Josephine had become in his mental recovery, the young girl as frankly suggested that he should stay as long as there was any hope of restoring his reason. Dr. Duchesne was delighted. With all his enthusiasm for science, he had a professional distrust of some of its disciples, and perhaps was not sorry to keep this most interesting case in his own hands. To him her suggestion was only a womanly kindness, tempered with womanly curiosity. But the astonishment and stupefaction of her parents at this evident corroboration of suspicions they had as yet only half believed was tinged with superstitious dread. Had she fallen in love with this helpless stranger? Or, more awful to contemplate, was he really no stranger, but a surreptitious lover thus strategically brought under her roof? For once they refrained from open criticism. The very magnitude of their suspicions left them dumb. It was thus that the virgin Chatelaine of Burnt Ridge Ranch was left to gaze untrammeled upon her pale and handsome guest, whose silken, bearded lips and sad, childlike eyes might have suggested a more exalted sufferer in their absence of any suggestion of a grosser material manhood. But even this imaginative appeal did not enter into her feelings. She felt for her good-looking, helpless patient a profound and honest pity. I do not know whether she had ever heard that pity was akin to love. She would probably have resented that utterly untenable and atrocious commonplace. There was no suggestion, real or elusive, of any previous masterful quality in the man which might have made his present dependent condition picturesque by contrast. He had come to her handicapped by an unromantic accident and a practical want of energy and intellect. He would have to touch her interest anew if, indeed, he would ever succeed in dispelling the old impression. His beauty, in a community of picturesquely handsome men, had little weight with her, except to accent the contrast with their fuller manhood. Her life had given her no illusions in regard to the other sex. She had found them, however, more congenial and safer companions than women, and more accessible to her own sense of justice and honor. In return, they had respected and admired rather than loved her, in spite of her womanly graces. If she had at times contemplated eventual marriage, it was only as a possible practical partnership in her business, but as she lived in a country where men thought it dishonorable and a proof of incompetency to rise by their wives' superior fortune, she had been free from that kind of mercenary persecution, even from men who might have worshipped her in hopeless and silent honor. For this reason, there was nothing in the situation that suggested a single compromising speculation in the minds of the neighbors, or disturbed her own tranquility. There seemed to be nothing in the future except a possible relief to her curiosity. Someday the unfortunate man's reason would be restored, and he would tell his simple history. Perhaps he might explain what was in his mind when he turned to her the first evening with that singular sentence which had often recurred strangely to her, she knew not why. It did not strike her until later that it was because it had been the solitary indication of an energy and capacity that seemed unlike him. Nevertheless, after that explanation, she would have been quite willing to have shaken hands with him and parted. And yet, for there was an unexpressed remainder in her thought, she was never entirely free or uninfluenced in his presence. The flickering vacancy of his sad eyes sometimes became fixed with a resolute immobility under the gentle questioning with which she had sought to draw out his faculties, that both piqued and exasperated her. He could say yes and no, as she thought intelligently, but he could not utter a coherent sentence nor write a word, except like a child in imitation of his copy. She taught him to repeat after her the names of the inanimate objects in the room, then the names of the doctor, his attendant, the servant, and, finally, her own under her Christian prenomen, with frontier familiarity, but when she pointed to himself he waited for her to name him. In vain she tried him with all the masculine names she knew, his was not one of them, or he would not or could not speak it. For at times she rejected the professional dictum of the doctor that the faculty of memory was wholly paralyzed or held in abeyance, even to the half-automatic recollection of his letters, yet she inconsistently began to teach him the alphabet with the same method, and in her sublime unconsciousness of his manhood with the same discipline as if he were a very child. When he had recovered sufficiently to leave his room, she would lead him to the porch before her window, and make him contented and happy by allowing him to watch her at work at her desk, occasionally answering his wondering eyes with a word, or stirring his faculties with a question. I grieve to say that her parents had taken advantage of this publicity and his supposed helpless condition to show their disgust of his assumption, to the extreme of making faces at him, an act which he resented with such a furious glare that they retreated hurriedly to their own veranda. A fresh though somewhat inconsistent grievance was added to their previous indictment of him: if we ain't found dead in our bed with our throats cut by that woman's crazy husband. They had settled by this time that there had been a clandestine marriage, we'll be lucky, groaned Mrs. Forsyth. Meantime, the mountain summer waxed to its fullness of fire and fruition. There were days when the crowded forest seemed choked and impeded with its own foliage, and pungent and stifling with its own rank maturity, when the long hillside ranks of wild oats, thick-set and impassable, filled the air with the heated dust of germination. In this quickening irritation of life, it would be strange if the unfortunate man's torpid intellect was not helped in its awakening, and he was allowed to ramble at will over the ranch, but with the instinct of a domestic animal he always returned to the house, and sat in the porch, where Josephine usually found him awaiting her when she herself returned from a visit to the mill. Coming thence one day, she espied him on the mountainside leaning against a projecting ledge in an attitude so rapt and immovable that she felt compelled to approach him. He appeared to be dumbly absorbed in the prospect, which might have intoxicated a saner mind. Half veiled by the heat that rose quiveringly from the fiery canyon below, the domain of Burnt Ridge stretched away before him, until, lifted in successive terraces hirsed and plumed with pines, it was at last lost in the ghostly snow peaks. But the practical Josephine seized the opportunity to try once more to awaken the slumbering memory of her pupil. Following his gaze with signs and questions, she sought to draw from him some indication of familiar recollection of certain points of the map thus unrolled behind him. But in vain. She even pointed out the fateful shadow of the overhanging ledge on the road where she had picked him up. There was no response in his abstracted eyes. She bit her lips, she was becoming irritated again. Then it occurred to her that, instead of appealing to his hopeless memory, she had better trust to some unreflective automatic instinct independent of it, and she put the question a little forward: when you leave us, where will you go from here? He stirred slightly, and turned towards her. She repeated her query slowly and patiently, with signs and gestures recognized between them. A faint glow of intelligence struggled into his eyes, he lifted his arm slowly, and pointed. Ah, those white peaks, the Sierras, she asked, eagerly. No reply. Beyond them. Yes. The States. No reply. Further still. He remained so patiently quiet and still pointing that she leaned forward, and, following with her eyes the direction of his hand, saw that he was pointing to the sky. Then a great quiet fell upon them. The whole mountainside seemed to her to be hushed, as if to allow her to grasp and realize for the first time the pathos of the ruined life at her side, which it had known so long, but which she had never felt till now. The tears came to her eyes, in her swift revulsion of feeling she caught the thin uplifted hand between her own. It seemed to her that he was about to raise them to his lips, but she withdrew them hastily, and moved away. She had a strange fear that if he had kissed them, it might seem as if some dumb animal had touched them, or it might not. The next day she felt a consciousness of this in his presence, and a wish that he was well cured and away. She determined to consult Dr. Duchesne on the subject when he next called. But the doctor, secure in the welfare of his patient, had not visited him lately, and she found herself presently absorbed in the business of the ranch, which at this season was particularly trying. There had also been a quarrel between Dick Shipley, her mill foreman, and Miguel, her ablest and most trusted vaquero, and in her strict sense of impartial justice she was obliged to side on the merits of the case with Shipley against her oldest retainer. This troubled her, as she knew that with the Mexican nature, fidelity and loyalty were not unmixed with quick and unreasoning jealousy. For this reason she was somewhat watchful of the two men when work was over, and there was a chance of their being thrown together. Once or twice she had remained up late to meet Miguel returning from the posada at San Ramon, filled with aguardiente and a recollection of his wrongs, and to see him safely bestowed before she herself retired. It was on one of those occasions, however, that she learned that Dick Shipley, hearing that Miguel had disparaged him freely at the posada, had broken the discipline of the ranch, and absented himself the same night that Miguel had leave, with a view of facing his antagonist on his own ground. To prevent this, the fearless girl at once secretly set out alone to overtake and bring back the delinquent. For 2 or 3 hours the house was thus left to the sole occupancy of Mr. and Mrs. Forsyth and the invalid, a fact only dimly suspected by the latter, who had become vaguely conscious of Josephine's anxiety, and had noticed the absence of light and movement in her room. For this reason, therefore, having risen again and mechanically taken his seat in the porch to await her return, he was startled by hearing her voice in the shadow of the lower porch, accompanied by a hurried tapping against the door of the old couple. The half-reasoning man arose, and would have moved towards it, but suddenly he stopped rigidly, with white and parted lips and vacantly distended eyeballs. Meantime the voice and muffled tapping had brought the tremulous fingers of old Forsyth to the door latch. He opened the door partly, a slight figure that had been lurking in the shadow of the porch pushed rapidly through the opening. There was a faint outcry quickly hushed, and the door closed again. The rays of a single candle showed the two old people hysterically clasping in their arms the figure that had entered, a slight but vicious-looking young fellow of 25. "There, d—n it," he said impatiently, in a voice whose rich depth was like Josephine's, but whose querulous action was that of the two old people before him, "let me go, and quit that, I didn't come here to be strangled. I want some money, you hear? Devilish quick, too, for I've got to be off again before daylight. So look sharp, will you? But, Stevie dear, when you didn't come that time 3 months ago, but wrote from Los Angeles, you said you'd made a strike at last, and—" "What are you talking about?" he interrupted violently. "That was just my lying to keep you from worrying me. 3 months ago, 3 months ago. Why, you must have been crazy to have swallowed it, I hadn't a cent." "Nor have we," said the old woman, shrilly. "That hellish sister of yours still keeps us like beggars. Our only hope was you, our own boy. And now you only come to go again. But she has money, she's doing well, and she shall give it to me," he went on, angrily. "She can't bully me with her business airs and morality. Who else has got a right to share, if it is not her own brother? Alas for the fatuousness of human malevolence." Had the unhappy couple related only the simple facts they knew about the new guest of Burnt Ridge Ranch, and the manner of his introduction, they might have spared what followed. But the old woman broke into a vindictive cry, "Who else, Steve, who else? Why, the slut has brought a man here, a sneaking, deceitful, underhanded, crazy lover." "Oh, has she?" said the young man, fiercely, yet secretly pleased at this promising evidence of his sister's human weakness. "Where is she? I'll go to her." "She's in her room, I suppose," and before they could restrain him, he had thrown off their impeding embraces and darted across the hall. The two old people stared doubtfully at each other. For even this powerful ally, whose strength, however, they were by no means sure of, might succumb before the determined Josephine. Prudence demanded a middle course. "Ain't they brother and sister?" said the old man, with an air of virtuous toleration. "Let 'em fight it out." The young man impatiently entered the room he remembered to have been his sister's. By the light of the moon that streamed upon the window he could see she was not there. He passed hurriedly to the door of her bedroom, it was open, the room was empty, the bed unturned. She was not in the house, she had gone to the mill. Ah! What was that they had said? An infamous thought passed through the scoundrel's mind. Then, in what he half believed was an access of virtuous fury, he began by the dim light to rummage in the drawers of the desk for such loose coin or valuables as, in the perfect security of the ranch, were often left unguarded. Suddenly he heard a heavy footstep on the threshold, and turned. An awful vision, a recollection, so unexpected, so ghost-like in that weird light that he thought he was losing his senses, stood before him. It moved forwards with staring eyeballs and white and open lips from which a horrible inarticulate sound issued that was the speech of no living man. With a single desperate, almost superhuman effort Stephen Forsyth bounded aside, leaped from the window, and ran like a madman from the house. Then the apparition trembled, collapsed, and sank in an undistinguishable heap to the ground. When Josephine Forsyth returned an hour later with her mill foreman, she was startled to find her helpless patient in a fit on the floor of her room. With the assistance of her now converted and penitent employee, she had the unfortunate man conveyed to his room, but not until she had thoughtfully rearranged the disorder of her desk and closed the open drawers without attracting Dick Shipley's attention. In the morning, hearing that the patient was still in the semi-conscious exhaustion of his late attack, but without seeing him, she sent for Dr. Duchesne. The doctor arrived while she was absent at the mill, where, after a careful examination of his patient, he sought her with some little excitement. "Well," she said, with eager gravity. "Well, it looks as if your wish would be gratified. Your friend has had an epileptic fit, but the physical shock has started his mental machinery again. He has recovered his faculties, his memory is returning, he thinks and speaks coherently, he is as sane as you and I." And said Josephine, questioning the doctor's knitted eyebrows, "I am not yet sure whether it was the result of some shock he doesn't remember, or an irritation of the brain, which would indicate that the operation had not been successful and that there was still some physical pressure or obstruction there, in which case he would be subject to these attacks all his life." "Do you think his reason came before the fit or after?" asked the girl, anxiously.
"I couldn't say.
Had anything happened?
I was away, and found him on the floor on my return," she answered, half uneasily.
After a pause she said, "Then he has told you his name and all about himself?"
"Yes, it's nothing at all. He was a stranger just arrived from the States, going to the mines, the old story, had no near relations, of course, wasn't missed or asked after, remembers walking along the ridge and falling over, name, John Baxter, of Maine." He paused, and relaxing into a slight smile, added, "I haven't spoiled your romance, have I?"
"No," she said, with an answering smile. Then as the doctor walked briskly away she slightly knitted her pretty brows, hung her head, patted the ground with her little foot beyond the hem of her gown, and said to herself, the man was lying to him. Chapter 3. On her return to the house, Josephine apparently contented herself with receiving the bulletin of the stranger's condition from the servant, for she did not enter his room. She had obtained no theory of last night's incident from her parents, who, beyond a querulous agitation that was quickened by the news of his return to reason, refrained from even that insidious comment which she half feared would follow. When another day passed without her seeing him, she nevertheless was conscious of a little embarrassment when his attendant brought her the request that she would give him a moment's speech in the porch, whither he had been removed. She found him physically weaker, indeed, so much so that she was fain, even in her embarrassment, to assist him back to the bench from which he had ceremoniously risen. But she was so struck with the change in his face and manner, a change so virile and masterful, in spite of its gentle sadness of manner, that she recoiled with a slight timidity as if he had been a stranger, although she was also conscious that he seemed to be more at his ease than she was. He began in a low exhausted voice, but before he had finished his first sentence, she felt herself in the presence of a superior. "My thanks come very late, Miss Forsyth," he said, with a faint smile, "but no one knows better than yourself the reason why, or can better understand that they mean that the burden you have so generously taken on yourself is about to be lifted."
"I know all, Miss Forsyth. Since yesterday I have learned how much I owe you, even my life I believe, though I am afraid I must tell you in the same breath that that is of little worth to anyone. You have kindly helped and interested yourself in a poor stranger who turns out to be a nobody, without friends, without romance, and without even mystery. You found me lying in the road down yonder, after a stupid accident that might have happened to any other careless tramp, and which scarcely gave me a claim to a bed in the county hospital, much less under this kindly roof. It was not my fault, as you know, that all this did not come out sooner, but while it doesn't lessen your generosity, it doesn't lessen my debt, and although I cannot hope to ever repay you, I can at least keep the score from running on. Pardon my speaking so bluntly, but my excuse for speaking at all was to say goodbye and God bless you. Dr. Duchesne has promised to give me a lift on my way in his buggy when he goes. There was a slight touch of consciousness in his voice in spite of its sadness, which struck the young girl as a weak and even ungentlemanly note in his otherwise self-abnegating and undemonstrative attitude. If he was a common tramp, he wouldn't talk in that way, and if he wasn't, why did he lie? Her practical good sense here asserted itself. But you are far from strong yet, in fact, the doctor says you might have a relapse at any moment, and you have that is, you seem to have no money, she said gravely. That's true, he said, quickly. I remember I was quite played out when I entered the settlement, and I think I had parted from even some little trifles I carried with me. I am afraid I was a poor find to those who picked me up, and you ought to have taken warning. But the doctor has offered to lend me enough to take me to San Francisco, if only to give a fair trial to the machine he has set once more a-going. Then you have friends in San Francisco, said the young girl quickly. Those who know you. Why not write to them first, and tell them you are here? I don't think your postmaster here would be preoccupied with letters for John Baxter, if I did, he said, quietly. But here is the doctor waiting. Goodbye. He stood looking at her in a peculiar, yet half-resigned way, and held out his hand. For a moment she hesitated. Had he been less independent and strong, she would have refused to let him go, have offered him some slight employment at the ranch, for oddly enough, in spite of the suspicion that he was concealing something, she felt that she would have trusted him, and he would have been a help to her. But he was not only determined, but she was all the time conscious that he was a totally different man from the one she had taken care of, and merely ordinary prudence demanded that she should know something more of him first. She gave him her hand constrainedly, he pressed it warmly. Dr. Duchesne drove up, helped him into the buggy, smiled a good-natured but half-perfunctory assurance that he would look after her patient, and drove away. The whole thing was over, but so unexpectedly, so suddenly, so unromantically, so unsatisfactorily, that, although her common sense told her that it was perfectly natural, proper, businesslike, and reasonable, and, above all, final and complete, she did not know whether to laugh or be angry. Yet this was her parting from the man who had but a few days ago moved her to tears with a single hopeless gesture. Well, this would teach her what to expect. Well, what had she expected? Nothing. Yet for the rest of the day she was unreasonably irritable, and, if the conjointure be not paradoxical, severely practical and inhumanly just. Falling foul of some presumption of Miguel's, based upon his prescriptive rights through long service on the estate, with the recollection of her severity towards his antagonist in her mind, she rated that trusted retainer with such pitiless equity and unfeminine logic that his hot Latin blood chilled in his veins, and he stood livid on the road. Then, informing Dick Shipley with equally relentless calm that she might feel it necessary to change all her foremen unless they could agree in harmony, she sought the dignified seclusion of her castle. But her respected parents, whose triumphant relief at the stranger's departure had emboldened them to await her return in their porch with bended bows of invective and lifted javelins of aggression, recoiled before the resistless helm of this cold-browed Minerva, who galloped contemptuously past them. Nevertheless, she sat late that night at her desk. The cold moon looked down upon her window, and lit up the empty porch where her silent guest had mutely watched her. For a moment she regretted that he had recovered his reason, excusing herself on the practical ground that he would never have known his dependence, and he would have been better cared for by her. She felt restless and uneasy. This slight divergence from the practical groove in which her life had been set had disturbed her in many other things, and given her the first views of the narrowness of it. Suddenly she heard a step in the porch. The lateness of the hour, perhaps some other reason, seemed to startle her, and she half rose. The next moment the figure of Miguel appeared at the doorway, and with a quick, hurried look around him, and at the open window, he approached her. He was evidently under great excitement, his hollow-shaven cheek looked like a waxen effigy in the mission church, his yellow, tobacco-stained eye glittered like phosphorescent amber, his lank gray hair was damp and perspiring, but more striking than this was the evident restraint he had put upon himself, pressing his broad-brimmed sombrero with both of his trembling yellow hands against his breast. The young girl cast a hurried glance at the open window and at the gun which stood in the corner, and then confronted him with clear and steady eyes, but a paler cheek. "Ah," he began in Spanish, which he himself had taught her as a child, "it was a strange thing, his coming there tonight, but, then, Mother of God. It was a strange, a terrible thing that she had done to him, old Miguel, her uncle's servant, he that had known her as a muchacha, he that had lived all his life at the ranch I, and whose fathers before him had lived there all their lives and driven the cattle over the very spot where she now stood, before the thieving Americans came here. But he would be calm, yes, the señora should find him calm, even as she was when she told him to go. He would not speak. No, he Miguel would contain himself, yes, he had mastered himself, but could he restrain others? Ah, yes, others, that was it. Could he keep Manuel and Pepe and Dominguez from talking to the milkman, that leaking sieve, that gabbling brute of a Shipley, for whose sake she had cast off her old servant that very day? She looked at him with cold astonishment, but without fear. Was he drunk with aguardiente, or had his jealousy turned his brain? He continued gasping, but still pressing his hat against his breast. Ah, he saw it all. Yes, it was today, the day he left. Yes, she had thought it safe to cast Miguel off now that he was gone. Without in the least understanding him, the color had leaped to her cheek, and the consciousness of it made her furious. "How dare you," she said, passionately. "What has that stranger to do with my affairs or your insolence?" He stopped and gazed at her with a certain admiring loyalty. "Ah, so," he said, with a deep breath, "the señora is the niece of her uncle. She does well not to fear him, a dog, with a slight shrug, who is more than repaid by the señora's condescension." He dare not speak. Who dare not speak? Are you mad? She stopped with a sudden terrible instinct of apprehension. "Miguel," she said in her deepest voice, "answer me, I command you. Do you know anything of this man?" It was Miguel's turn to recoil from his mistress. "Ah, my God, is it possible the señora has not suspect?" "Suspect," said Josephine, haughtily, albeit her proud heart was beating quickly. "I suspect nothing. I command you to tell me what you know." Miguel turned with a rapid gesture and closed the door. Then, drawing her away from the window, he said in a hurried whisper, "I know that that man has not the name of Baxter. I know that he has the name of Randolph, a young gambler, who have won a large sum at Sacramento, and, fearing to be robbed by those he won of, have walked to himself through the road in disguise of a miner. I know that your brother Esteban have decoyed him here, and have fallen on him." "Stop," said the young girl, her eyes, which had been fixed with the agony of conviction, suddenly flashing with the energy of despair. "And you call yourself the servant of my uncle, and dare say this of his nephew?" "Yes, señora," broke out the old man, passionately. "It is because I am the servant of your uncle that I, and I alone, dare say it to you. It is because I perjured my soul, and have perjured my soul to deny it elsewhere, that I now dare to say it. It is because I, your servant, knew it from one of my countrymen, who was of the gang, because I, Miguel, knew that your brother was not far away that night, and because I, whom you would dismiss, have picked up this pocketbook of Randolph's and your brother's ring which he have dropped, and I have found beneath the body of the man you sent me to fetch." He drew a packet from his bosom, and tossed it on the desk before her. "And why have you not told me this before?" said Josephine, passionately. Miguel shrugged his shoulders. What good? Possibly this dog Randolph would die. Possibly he would live as a lunatic. Possibly would happen what has happened. The Senora is beautiful. The American has eyes. If the Dona Josephine's beauty shall finish what the silly Don Esteban's arm have begun, what matter? Stop, cried Josephine, pressing her hands across her shuddering eyes. Then, uncovering her white and set face, she said rapidly, saddle my horse and your own at once. Then take your choice. Come with me and repeat all that you have said in the presence of that man, or leave this ranch forever. For if I live I shall go to him tonight, and tell the whole story. The old man cast a single glance at his mistress, shrugged his shoulders, and, without a word, left the room. But in 10 minutes they were on their way to the county town. Day was breaking over the distant burnt ridge, a faint, ghostly level, like a funeral pall, in the dim horizon as they drew up before the gaunt, white-painted pile of the hospital building. Josephine uttered a cry. Dr. Duchesne's buggy was before the door. On its very threshold they met the doctor, dark and irritated. Then you heard the news, he said, quickly. Josephine turned her white face to the doctor's. What news? She asked, in a voice that seemed strangely deep and resonant. The poor fellow had another attack last night, and died of exhaustion about an hour ago. I was too late to save him. Did he say anything? Was he conscious? Asked the girl, hoarsely. No, incoherent. Now I think of it, he harped on the same string as he did the night of the operation. What was it he said? You remember? You'll have to kill me first, repeated Josephine, in a choking voice. Yes, something about his dying before he'd tell. Well, he came back to it before he went off, they often do. You seem a little hoarse with your morning ride. You should take care of that voice of yours. By the way, it's a good deal like your brother's. Asterisk 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 asterisk. The Chatelaine of Burnt Ridge never married.